All right, welcome back to the last main tutorial of this arm wound series. So we're pretty much done with all the cool effects, and now I just need to address some things that need to be corrected. So let's take a look at what we have so far. All right, so what we've got so far would be good enough really to send for a review for a client to see if this is something that they would be interested in. But there are quite a few tech fixes that would have to be made here. Probably the most time-consuming one is going to be fixing the roto of the fingers over the gauze pad on the front side of the gauze pad here. It's fairly close, but you can see if I just scrub, they kind of wobble a little bit. So more time needs to be spent fixing the roto here. I'm not going to show how to do that. It's just trial and error and trying to figure out a good boundary for your feathering. There are some other techniques that you could use, such as keying out the gauze pad, but I'm not really going to show that here. I think mine's pretty close. Just go back into the fingers roto and finesse these masks so they're not jittering. But that's something that we're not really going to go over. It'll just be too time consuming to do for a tutorial like this. So as we flip over the gauze pad here, you can see that there's some kind of weird parallax issue with the gauze pad, where the gauze pad stain doesn't track perfectly well, especially right here. We can see how that kind of moves up a little bit. So for this type of thing, you'd want to use either a corner pin or a mesh warp tool. It's most prominent right here at around frame 125, 124, something around there. So what we could do for that, on the gauze pad back comp, you could grab a mesh warp effect. Now I would put all your transforms and tracking effects above your color correction. So the way this effect works, you basically just keyframe the distortion mesh. I'm going to click E for effects and then just open up the mesh warp effect here. So the way this works, you have to go just a few frames at a time so we can see how that's sliding up. So we can take this point and start pulling this down. It's just the full resolution so we can see that a little bit more clearly. You do the same thing with this point up here. Start pushing this down. Now the mesh warp tool is one of the hardest tools to manipulate, in my opinion. It's very, very tedious, but it's something that would be necessary to do in this case. A corner pin potentially could work as well, but I think the mesh warp is actually going to be easier since you can just control sections of the image at once instead of the entire thing. We want to pull down this corner as well. And then it's just a case of going frame by frame and checking for movement. We can start back at frame 124 and just step through. So right here, this is pretty good. And then at frame 129, we see this part kind of emerge. That's kind of I think that's playing in with the fact that this is multiplied. So what I would recommend in this case, going into that gauze pad front layer, grabbing a pen tool, and then just masking out a little bit more of this area. We'll set that to be a subtractive mat, and then we'll still keep in some of that edge, but we'll feather it. Then we'll see what this looks like. And now we're no longer getting that kind of creeping shadow area, which is going to look a little bit better. So again, this is something else that's extremely tedious to do, but it is necessary. You could spend several hours fixing the track on both the roto and the gauze pad as it flips over. So I've done just a few frames, but you would have to extend this all the way to around frame 140, maybe 150. That's something that I'm not really going to show in the video. It's something that you just need to look at. And every effect is going to be different. So depending on how large your texture is, you might not even notice. You just want to prevent it. You want to keep pushing it over to the left-hand side so it doesn't creep over to the right as the gauze pad is being turned. This is something you're just going to have to work on by yourself. So for this next part, there's an issue that's caused by the actual plate itself. So I'm just going to turn on my color correction and the plate. It'll be a little bit easier to see. Notice how the plate gets much brighter and darker here. This is actually in the plate. So the camera is a lot brighter here, and probably because this gets so bright, it's trying to auto expose itself, and then it goes darker again. If we turn our effects back on here, all of the veins are overlaid, so they are fine. We don't have to do anything to that. but on the wound, in order to match the wound comp with the plate, we're going to actually have to animate a curves to match that light change. Let's go ahead, add a curves. Well, we don't even see it until around frame 95-ish. Yeah, so at frame 94, keyframe the curves effect. And then it looks like it goes to around frame 115. And actually, I need to keyframe this, just add a manual keyframe here, and then we need to go back because at the beginning, it's actually supposed to be a bit brighter. And to match the brightness, I'm just going to pull up the black values just a little bit there, and then we'll go and see what that looks like as we animate it. So now this is looking a little bit brighter, and then a little bit later on, it begins to get a little bit brighter again. So at around frame 123, it starts to get a little brighter again, so we'll keyframe, just manual keyframe there. And then we'll go to the point where it is the brightest, which it looks like it kind of levels off at around 135. And then we'll just pull this up very slightly. And I'm actually going to take all of these and just ease them. So now we've kind of matched the light a little bit better between 105 and 135. Mostly in the shadows, but it looks a little bit better integrated now. Now within this same range here, we also notice that if you look at the skin, or if you look at the hair on my arm here, it's pretty sharp, or it's a little out of focus, but it's still pretty sharp there. Let's go all the way down to like 118, 116. This is very blurry, and then it comes back up by around 135 again. So we also need to animate that. Now, because we already have a camera lens blur on here, I want to leave this one as just basically a static camera lens blur. So let's go ahead and add a second camera lens blur, and we'll just animate this one. So it starts off here at 0 at 135. We'll just do this backwards. And it looks like at around frame 101 or 102, this begins to kind of lose focus. So we'll set another keyframe, and then around 116, it gets pretty blurry. So let's increase that blur to around 2. Or actually, we could even go a bit more with that. We could double that, go to 4. It's actually pretty blurry. Maybe 3. When in doubt, add a little bit more defocus. All right, so now what we can do, we can take a copy of this camera lens blur, and we need to paste it on all the other effects, with some caveats. So first of all, let's actually just go down and start on the marble textures here. When you paste an effect with keyframes, and After Effects, you need to make sure that you're on the starting frame of those keyframes. So we're starting at 101, so we need to be at frame 101 when we paste the effect. But if you're pasting an effect that currently exists, it will just overwrite that effect. So if I just pasted this right here, it overwrites the existing camera lens blur, which I don't want to do. So in this case, I'm going to grab a second camera lens blur. I'll just put this on top, and then I'll paste it. So you have to do that for each one. So we've already done that for the wound comp there. Do it for the shadow comp here. Do it for the veins left comp. I'm going to skip over that displacement layer for a moment. Grab a new effect for this one, paste that in. Because these veins right and veins left displacement adjustment layers are adjustment layers, they're affecting everything. So this CC glass is actually affecting the entire plate. So if we were just to simply put a camera lens blur on underneath here, we'd end up blurring the entire plate, which is not what we want. So we're going to take a copy of the veins right comp and the gauze pad roto, duplicate these, and we're going to place these above the veins right displace and its mat. Then we're going to precompose this and just call this exactly what it is, veins right mat for defocus, and click OK. Solo this, make sure that the alpha is free. Yep. Okay, next we can grab underneath this layer, an adjustment layer, and then this veins right defocus is going to have an alpha track mat, and I'm going to grab a copy of that camera lens blur, go to my veins right defocus, and paste that in. So then at frame 116, if we toggle this on and off, it's now receiving blur. It's very subtle, but if you zoom in, this is not as sharp. So if everything else was getting more blurred and that wasn't, you would notice. All right, so we have to do the same thing on the left-hand side. I'll speed this up now. And now we have the same effect on this one as well. Okay, it's pretty subtle. It sounds like a lot of work. And we are getting a lot of comps here, so that's just the way the After Effects works, I'm afraid. There are ways to mitigate that with set mat effects and things like that, and a lot of expressions, but I didn't want to go too far into doing expressions in this one. Anyway, so we're now reaching a point where we're pretty much done with this in terms of, you know, the main thing that we're going for. There are going to be, as I said, a lot of tech fixes, but there's another main effect that we can add to this just to help this blend in a little bit better. All right, so let's go down to the wound comp. I think this is going to be the easiest one to do this on. Add some grain to the wound comp here. So you always want to do your grain on the last type of effect, even after a camera lens blur. If you blur grain, you're defeating the purpose, obviously. And grain effects are quite intensive to do, so I'd only recommend doing this at the end. And you're going to have to do this on a effect-by-effect basis here. If you try to do it on everything, you'll end up covering the plate again, which obviously is not what you want to do. So with match grain, if you are not done with your project or you're trying to work on it and it's been slow, just turn it off and then come back and re-enable it later. So anyway, make sure this is set to final output. And then the noise source layer, this is going to be the plate. And let's zoom in here. And this is going to be a bit more clear if I solo my comp and then zoom in. Grain is especially noticeable in shadowed areas. So what this effect is doing is just sampling random points on the plate and trying to copy the same amount of grain or kind of pixel distortion, because this plate is not the greatest quality. So by adding match grain effects to all of your main components, it's really going to help make a difference. So you wouldn't need to do it for things that are overlaid, because you're already going to get quite a bit of grain in there. If you realize that certain effects aren't picking up enough grain, then of course you can go ahead and do that. But for this, I'm only going to do it on the ones that don't have a blending mode and aren't covered by other effects. Like this comp shadow here is covered by the veins left comp. Put one on the veins left comp, and I'll do the same thing on the veins right comp as well. A very subtle effect, but I think you will notice. Also, I'm not going to bother with the smaller veins ones, because they are overlaid, so they're probably picking up some of the grain. On some of these larger elements, like this gauze pad stain, gauze pad back, by adding a little bit of grain in there, it's going to probably just help integrate it very slightly. It's very subtle. It's more noticeable when it's in motion. And you could do the same thing here as well if you wanted to. I don't think it's going to be necessary here. It's mostly for things that kind of really stand out, like that arm wound. And adding the match grain effect is actually going to slow down your render quite a bit. All right, guys, so I think I've covered everything that I really intended to on this tutorial. And actually, I think I've gone a bit more than what I originally thought I was going to go over. But so this shot isn't technically done. There's a lot of work that has to be done in the tech fixes, like softening these edges on the roto, making sure that there's no kind of jittering. But I think the most fun part, which is the wound itself, I think that looks pretty good. And I hope that gives you some kind of inspiration for your own projects. If you're doing something with a completely different set of plates, I hope that the techniques that I've shown you are pretty useful. All right, so that kind of wraps up this video. I'll show my example again at the end, because I have spent a lot more time on the tech fixes on that one. I don't really have the time to really fix up this one. And personally, I do prefer the other one, although I quite like the new veins and this kind of extra pattern that I've added here, which of course is the most fun part. So again, if you're not doing like a nasty wound like this, you're doing some kind of light effect, or you have some kind of growing tattoo, or the opposite of this, where like a wound is healing up, the same tech fixes would be involved, and the overall lighting and composition would be essentially the same as well. So after this video, what I'm going to do is show a supplemental video going into Maya and playing around with some 3D paint effects that we could use to kind of generate either something to combine with our 2D effect, or something completely different from scratch, but it is 3D, so you can get like realistic reflections and light interactions and things like that. We're not going to come back to the comp though, so this is it. If you have any other questions though, just let me know, and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. All right, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Peace.